So we want to understand the steps. We're going to do a couple cases here in the class for shaping. Put you into groups. But a few things we want to be concerned with. One is identifying the terminal or target behavior that we're trying to achieve, right? Looking at a list. And specifying which positive reinforcements we'll use. Also specifying if we're using differential reinforcement, we're thinking of using positive reinforcement and extinction techniques, right? So things that we're gonna try to remove at the same time, things we're trying to add at the same time. We're gonna look at specifying initial and intermediate responses. Remember we talked about with successive approximations. So if we want to change a behavior, we take little tiny steps. We measure those steps, we see what works, and then we add reinforcements where we see things work, and we don't add reinforcements where things are not changing. Lastly, we'll look at the schedule of reinforcements, and then reinforce initial response each time it occurs and withhold reinforcement from the other responses until initial response is performed consistently. So here's our case I'm gonna get for each group. Let's say three. All right, so group one, thinking of successive approximation and differential response techniques, how would you help someone stop smoking? Right, you're an analyst, you're an assessor, client comes in, has trouble with smoking, and now you're trying to think of things you're going to try to extinguish, things you're going to try to add as a reinforcement to get to the terminal behavior of quitting smoking. This would be your target. So get together, think of techniques. I say, I want to see at least five. Either reinforcements or extinction protocols. Things you'll remove, things you'll add to just want to quit smoking. Group two in the bag, maybe you can link up with them. Let's say fast food, junk food, fast food is your case. Right, client comes in. They are suffering with some form of obesity in some case, particularly due to compulsion and impulses of eating fast food, and particularly, really focus on the fast food. How would you help someone do step-by-step approximations and reinforce, good behavior versus extinguishing bad behavior to get them to stop eating fast food? All right, in group three, remember, try to think of five steps, at least five approximations, right? Five things you want to look at to measure that either, you're going to use for positive reinforcement or things you're going to remove for extinguishing certain behaviors. So group three, let's say you can do social media. So client comes in, addiction to social media, right? And they want to change that behavior. What are some of the successive approximations, your step-by-step sequence to help them stop, lessen the degree of use? I would say completely stop using it, but lessen the degree of use. So maybe you can get with them in that group. Three. Sounds good? All right, let's take a few minutes to look at what you come up with. Remember, as a therapist or behavioral analyst, you're trying to look at things you can observe that would be clearly identifiable to helping you achieve your target response, right? Your target behavior. So So try to think as critically as possible of like, hey, what are the steps to smoking? You know, think of what are the actual steps that involves smoking. And if there are these steps, what could you do to either reinforce or remove, extinguish in this process of step to smoking, right? And maybe also think of maybe some of the stimulating factors for it. You say, well, what does it involve? What does smoking involve? What's the end game there? Well, you know, think of what the end game is for someone who loves to smoke. Also think of some of the possibilities of why one would even come to smoking in the first place. Taking other psychology courses, so you may go link some things, Freudian theories, Skinner theories, et cetera, et cetera. Same for you back there. You know, think of what are the steps, in essence, you really can analyze self, right? If you're thinking about fast food, you can literally think of like, what are the steps for why I want to eat fast food, right? What are the steps of me going to McDonald's, Burger King, Taco Bell, what have you? And how would even you yourself extinguish that behavior? Because it's not, oh, I'm just gonna stop eating fast food, you know, that doesn't work. So think of the step-by-step process in which you maybe help yourself stop eating fast food. Same goes to social media. I think that was a little bit more harder, right? Because the devices are necessary, right? So if you think of how would you go about using different steps, successive approximations to curb your use on social media, and what are some ways you can reinforce that, or what are some things you can take away to extinguish some, you know, sort of behaviors that make you do it in the first place. So take a few minutes. Let's say try to come up with, you can come up with five of each, that'd be great, but come up with as many as you possibly can.
It's a word.
Because that's just me.
Thank you.
What'd you say?
I'm single-handed, make sure you graduate.
Boy, shake your way. You are not single-handedly. Thunderfire is also true. Three passes on some classes that I did.
Give it about another 3 minutes. All right, maybe we'll start with group three until Will returns back to class. Okay, so the use of social media. Before you tell me your process and method, I want you to think of maybe motivations or drivers for doing such things as having compulsions to constantly go on social media. What are some of your observations about why people go on social media so much throughout the course of the day?
I think notifications on your phone and through your friends are constantly like mentioning them sharing stuff. It tends to make you want to stay on social media so you're up to date and you don't miss anything.
So FOMO, all right? Notifications, so that's a setting, right, in your phone that maybe you can alter or change. Okay, what else? Like, what are some other drivers you think that make people constantly just check their phones and have to see what's happening on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok?
Well, the key also, like, hanging out with friends, that should be, like, for family, or that should be, like, quality time with them.
Mm-hmm.
But you might notice that they're constantly on their phone, not present in the moment, so that might be a juicy thing, like, well, if everyone else is on their phone, then what does that lead you to do? So then you'll be tempted as well to keep your eye on your phone.
Okay. So sort of social force or social proof or something to that like.
Mm-hmm.
Alright. Anything else you could think of? Alright, what did you come up with?
So if you're tempted to use your phone, well, obviously you could put it on, like you said, it's a setting, so you could put it on do not disturb or just mute social media notifications, so you're still receiving more messages because the whole topic is just social media. And then if you want to lessen the use of it, it doesn't mean that you're not allowed to get on it, just maybe set a schedule of where you could fit it in. Like, let's say you're doing homework and you want to take a break. The break, your reward break could be like 15 minutes on social media. But what we were saying is that the most influential seems to be TikTok because it's a little bit of everything, like a little bit of news, a little bit of like music industry, artists, anything like that. So just, I guess, like limited by schedule, and then little by little, you might just forget about it if you're staying busy. And you could probably substitute it for something else, like going to the gym, or walking, or reading, or using. Or she mentioned that if you feel the need to like use your phone, get something to substitute it, like a fidget or something, rather than using your phone.
Okay. So one thing you're saying is rewarding, using social media as a reward instead of a common use feature. Notification settings, obviously, is something physically we can change, right, and alter. Have you considered using other apps instead of social media? Like, maybe the arrangement of the apps on your phone, right? Maybe if you say, hey, on my initial screen, I have all my social media apps and my mail and calendar and all that stuff. What if you rearrange the social media apps to, like, put it on the third page of your screen or something, right? Or maybe put other apps which would be more educational, like maybe Wikipedia or just Google or something, and that first sort of page, would that alter your behavior? Would become a nuisance to scroll 3, 4, or 5 pages just to get to TikTok, Facebook, right? But leave it there, right, as a way of sort of punishing yourself for having it in the first place on your phone. So yeah, all good things. I think we could probably think of maybe 20 other ways we could go about, you know, rewarding ourselves for it or altering just the device itself, because the issue is the device, right? It's like the device, how we manage this device and how we use it and arrange it and organize things on it are probably the reason why we see, make it so easy for us to access the social media apps altogether. Okay, good. Fast food. What did you come up with? Well, okay, before that, let me ask you the motivation, right? The motivating drivers for fast food, right? And you can just speak from personal experience. Like, what is the drivers for us to get fast food knowing that it's bad? It's going to make us gain weight. The food probably is going to make our stomach hurt later. You know, all these different negative effects. Why are we still doing it?
So we thought about convenience, and then
okay.
Maybe you just like the way it tastes.
So convenience and short-term case, maybe, right? Okay. Okay, so what'd you come up with? How are you gonna wing somebody off fast food?
We said having groceries at home.
Okay, so having groceries at home, but if convenience is a motivation or driver, getting groceries sounds like a huge inconvenience. So how would you get the groceries at home?
With already having them there.
Okay, which would maybe find that, you know, observing the behavior why somebody would do something, would you say like maybe ordering? That having groceries delivered may substitute like convenience, right? If convenience is a behavior trait, like maybe that not going to the grocery store is the answer, but rather ordering groceries might be a better solution, right? If you're like, this person is impulsive, they want something now, they don't want to wait, right? Going to the grocery store is 1 hour thing. What about selection of foods? Did you think about that? If you are going, if you're getting groceries at home, what kind of foods do you think will help this individual?
Well, we also talked about like doing meal prep. So like
okay.
A lot of the convenience is more like in the moment. Like if someone, everyone's typical day, like they have only a certain amount of time that they have to get food and eat. So like if you were to implement like a certain time later in the evening that the person could meal prep just for the day after or for the whole week in advance, then it kind of takes out like the possibility of them just relying on fast food for a convenient meal. But like the question you were asking, we also talked about like substitution. So like if you really like cheeseburgers, finding a somewhat healthier alternative like that's similar, like getting like lean meat and like a whole grain bun, something like that that's not as like loaded with grease and fat, to like kind of transition into like a more healthy eating choice that doesn't necessarily sacrifice like the actual food item.
Okay. Those are all good. Anyone else can think of some other ways to stop someone with fast food? Getting fast food? Yes.
I was gonna say like the ordering groceries, like I think it's HelloFresh, so like the meal ingredients recipes to make.
Yeah. So you can get ready made meals delivered, right? Yeah. Instead of actually ordering a full load of groceries. But we always have to think about what's really the stimulus here. The stimulus is, it's just quick and maybe it's cheap, right? So maybe an economic factor might be there as well too, right? It's like, oh, okay, McDonald's cheeseburgers are $2 or something like that, right? So what can we substitute $2 that's not gonna be as bad as going to McDonald's? Okay, group one, smoking. Well, first I was asking all the other groups, Will, before you came back, is what is the main drivers you believe are the main drivers or motivations for smoking?
So to start with, it's the nicotine. It gets you chemically hooked to it.
So one is the chemical.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
So it starts as the good feeling, and then later on it gets to the point of when I don't have the chemical in my body, I get bad feelings. So when I want to continuously take it to avoid that.
Get anxious.
Yes. And then, well it's a physically uncomfortable feeling, but yeah, also it's that bad. And then there's also the ritual aspect of a lot of people get that I'm going to take a smoke break, and that becomes a ritual of relaxation and that sort of thing. Not necessarily chemically it does anything for them, but then stepping outside.
So smoking is an act that involves many steps, right?
Yes.
So what are the acts of smoking? One is think about it, right? Your observation. Pull it out of your pockets in a nice box. Box feels nice to hold, right? Even if you don't smoke, the act of smoking is actually kind of cool. People like smack the box against their hand, right? This whole ritual aspect, flip it open, get it out. Maybe it feels good within the fingers. So you're like, well, okay, there's a holding aspect to this oral fixation, right? Because in essence, the source of it is an oral fixation, right? Yes, the nicotine is the end result or the byproduct of it, but we ultimately want something in our mouth constantly, right? And we know from Freudian theory, usually it happens in the oral phase as a child, which is your first phase, right? You are born, you have to suck on your mother's breast in order to survive and live, right? You cry with your mouth in order to get people to respond and do stuff for you. Some mechanism to get people to act. And something usually goes wrong in that period. Either someone's been on the binky or the pacifier too long, sucking on their mother's breast for too long, allowed to get what they want each time they cry, people immediately respond, something of that sort, right? In the oral phase. So with oral fixations, we say, all right, it's the act of having something in your mouth. It feels good, right? Back and forth, 100 times, cigarette goes in your mouth. But it's also the chemical byproduct that flows the end result. And maybe a social aspect, right? Maybe you're a social smoker, right? You take a cigarette break, and it's this whole ritual of the interaction with smokers. Because you're like, well, guess what? I can do my best thinking when I smoke, right? Because I'm in my most comforting state or something, right? And so you want to socialize with others. So it could be social. All right, so what did you come up with in terms of approximations?
So we did, when you go out to do a smoke break, first replace the actual cigarette, just stop it and replace it with a breathing technique, some kind of actual relaxation. Mm-hmm. So it could be actually like a meditation or a mindfulness or something, or just a breathing technique. And then two, so that's one is just replace the activity, but then something that actually relaxes you to keep it with that. Two, reward not smoking with small treats. So like when I do go out on my cigarette break, that is now a breathing break or whatever, I pop a Breath Mint or a candy or something at the end of it and reward that. We said if you want to continue to have nicotine in your system, nicotine gum or patches, and then work on weaning that off and figure out like a time plan and a spread for that. And then I said try to incorporate morning gym or exercise to start the day energized and in an endorphin to be like, I don't know, some people start the day with a cigarette or whatnot, but just either way, getting that like positive, good feeling going, and then throughout the day, trying to keep it going.
Okay. So we say, all right, if smoking causes us to be anxious when we don't have it, right? Therefore, working out will put us in a different mood instead of being, where we're not anxious, right?
So yeah,
if we're not anxious, we're not going to really want it.
Yeah.
It may give us a little bit more time.
Preventing the desire for it ahead of time. And then this is from Nathaniel. He said, break their fucking kneecaps if they light that devil's power.
All right, so.
But negative reinforcement if they.
Negative reinforcement. All right, that's a bit extreme, Nathaniel. You know? Although I did see that on page 336 about breaking the kneecaps. Okay, so some physical punishment. Maybe you pinch yourself or something, right? I've seen practice where people have worn like barbed wire on their legs, like on their thighs, and usually like prick themselves. Something that they would use. Those are actually like religious rituals, like Mother Teresa and stuff like that would wear barbed wire as a reminder to like light the suffering type of thing, right? So if you could maybe do something physical, not break your knees, but like rubber band, pop yourself, right? Each time you think about maybe the desire to smoke. All right, excellent. Everybody can return back to their seats and move. But this goes to show you that this is not easy work, right? It seems simple in theory, but to actually move from one to perfect one step to another takes a lot of patience. It takes a lot of time. Because here we're just being loose with it, like, oh, okay, we'll do this, we'll do that. Like, in theory, that all sounds great. But how it actually works, it needs to be extinguished. Each step needs to extinguish an undesired behavior before we move to our terminal behavior that we're trying to obtain. All right, but there's some external factors, right? So here the chapter talks about some rules of behaviorism. All right, so there are some external factors, right? But there's also some factors that we should consider when looking at behavior itself. Right, when looking at behavior, we don't do morals, right? We don't acknowledge morals in our assessment. Right, when we assess behavior, morality is not a non-factor, right? There is no good or evil. We are to be neutral, right? Because behavior doesn't really indicate something of a moral compass either way. It just indicates something that a person is stimulated to do. Right, there are almost no win-win situations. There's no perfection in any of this. We know this from our own lives. There's no perfect behavior, right? Things happen, we transition, we're constantly evolving as human beings, we age, right? There are physical changes that happen to us that we can't really control, right? So there are no win-win, but somebody's going to pay in some way with your behavior, right? So the cigarettes, most likely you'll pay because it'll be your health, and you'll also be paying somebody because it costs money to buy this expensive stuff all the time. Here's one of the questions, theoretical questions to ask, right? Who wins with increased crime, disease, or car crashes? Right, there are no win-wins, so who wins? I don't know. Nobody wins. Maybe somebody does win, right?
Insurance
company. There you go, right? Who wins with diseases? Medical doctors, physicians, medical facilities, researchers, laboratories, grant funding institutions, all sorts of things. Who wins with increased crime? Right? Penal systems, right? Kind of like, hey, my dad works at the jail. He's a warden and a security guard or something. But with no people in jail, your dad will be unemployed, right? Thus, there may be a need for people to be in jail in order to facilitate something else for someone else. Okay, people act in their best interests, right? Only usually in the short term. We usually act impulsively in our best interest in the short term. It's only when we've done things for a long period of time that we may consider reevaluations to do things for others. But for the most part, we act in our self-interest, our best interest, usually. Right? So when people say that you're, hey, you are self-centered or you're selfish, in reality, you can tell them, right? And, you know, everybody is, right? In some degree. When it comes to fast food, people would rather do easy stuff than hard stuff, right? Easy to go get something cheap at McDonald's. It doesn't require, you just pull up in your car, the drive-thru, you don't have to get out, Apple Pay, right, whatever. Very easy. Going to the grocery store requires work, gotta get out the car, get a car, takes time to find things that may have it, that may not have it. Who knows, right? So we'll move towards the convenience and other things. We don't do willpower in behaviorism. Why would we not do willpower? Probably not focus it at all. It's usual willpower. Yes.
Because like at some point someone's gonna get discouraged. Like if they are going to try and change a behavior, just saying like put your mind to it, will yourself to do it, then like you can get really discouraging when they're trying and something's not working.
Our brain doesn't work in a turn on, shut off mechanism, right? Life is not black and white. It's not like tomorrow you say, oh, I'm going to stop doing this. It doesn't work that way because we're stimulated constantly, right? This is perpetual, right? We're stimulated constantly by so many external environmental factors that we don't really say there's a willpower in our field, right? Maybe the ultimate goal is a philosophical thing to say, hey, I've overcome myself, right? I've overcome my challenges and my bad habits, right? But that's more of a philosophical idea rather than actual practical thing. Reinforcements can be weird, so think. We're going to try to get as creative as possible with reinforcements, right? We're thinking of very generic, general things on how to reinforce behavior, but we can be extremely creative on items that we use, activities that we could sort of utilize to help people get over bad or negative habits. Different people react to differently to the same reinforcement, right? So it doesn't work for all. These reinforcements are not something that are consistent because we all come from different cultures. Some of us speak different languages. Some of us have different backgrounds growing up, right? Which means we all get different responses, stimulations, all sorts of things. Right? And we also have different personalities altogether, right? We think of, things like personality theory, personality traits, or you can get deeper into sociopathy and psychopathy. A lot of us do have sociopathic traits, right? But we're not sociopaths, but we do have, which means we probably don't have responses in the same way to things that others do emotionally. Okay. All right, here we're talking about externality, the cost or benefit that affects a third party who did not choose to incur that cost or benefit, right? And so here the chapter's talking about, why are textbooks so freaking expensive, right? So you're either being rewarded or punished for a behavior you did not demonstrate. Here we give an example of air pollution from cars. They're negative externalities, right? We're all breathing in this bad air outside because people are driving cars. Maybe we don't even drive ourselves, right? So who's being punished for it? Who's being rewarded for it? Will the system cause an increase or decrease in air pollution? Something to consider. The education system, positive externality. An employer wants to hire bright people, right? You can only really maybe tell if you're bright, right? Either through a conversation or maybe through your credentials, right? So getting a bachelor's degree is nothing more than a credential, right? A credential of a completion of a program that, that's one that is of intellect. Who's being punished in the education system? Who's being rewarded, right? So think of some externalities with that. In terms of coming to college and getting your degree, what are some of the positive reinforcements for staying here? Like, what are some things you use as reinforcements to remain consistent throughout this program? What are some of the punishments too? Yeah. Okay, so you say, hey, in my mind, like, the more I engage and socialize, the more it reinforces my behavior to actually enjoy these 4 years that I've spent in college, right? What else? Like, what's keeping you here? It has to be something that keeps you here every day. Yeah, we know the long-term thing is to finish a degree, but like we said, that's a fanciful thought about the future that we don't know will ever come, right? But what are we doing consistently as a pattern to reinforce our behavior to say, I'm going to just keep going this semester? Yeah.
Like resources as a reinforcement, like you've already dedicated your time and your money into something. And like, I'm pretty sure most of us here are upperclassmen. So like getting so far is like, you have to complete it because then like, what was the point of doing it before? When you put so much energy, time, and money into it.
All right, so a mindset of like accumulated energy, time, effort as a means to say, okay, using that as sort of motivation to complete the task. Anyone else have some other motivation or drivers that keeps you going for school? I'm pretty sure parents are an externality too, right? The parents may be motivating you to keep coming there, and probably they could be paying for it as well too. That's a great motivator as well too. And then principal, right? Principal is a person with money. Agent is a person spending money. That's what they're talking about here. And what happened when you spend someone else's money, right? What's the benefit of spending someone else's money? That has a positive outcome. Think of even if you're taking student loans, you're in essence spending someone else's money. Yeah, you may pay it back, you may not. So there's some reinforcements there too. And then textbooks. Let's see what they talk about textbooks. Who are they selling to? Is this good for the students? Students are spending money. What else are they spending? Should I take that into account? I'm not really sure what they're trying to get here with the textbook. All right, what do you do when a textbook is very expensive? What is your sort of successive approximations to getting the information that you need when a textbook is too expensive for the class? What do you do? Yeah.
I go to textbooks and get it for $12.
For how much?
$12.
So every book is $12?
I mean, my health psychology book, you know, someone for 40 years that had a contract book for 12.
Okay. So you find a place where you can get it for $12. What else do you do?
Pirate it.
Huh?
Pirate it.
You pirate it, right?
For free, bitch.
Yeah, right? And, you know, there's some professors who do that as well, too.
I would encourage it.
But really, but really, we get the books for free. The professors get them. What else? What are some other ways you could go about getting that information for class? If the textbooks are expensive. Yeah, you could go and borrow, right? The point is we alter our behavior based on an expensive textbook, and we'll find out ways to use successive approximations to achieve our end goal of being able to have the information we need to get the work done.